then I went to junior high, and I actually wrote a poem. And I don't know why or how I came to write the poem. I just remember it was a poem about a werewolf, and it was published in the school yearbook. Now, I grew up in a pretty tough working-class neighborhood in the Bronx in New York. When some of the tougher kids in the school found out I'd written a poem, I got beat up because that wasn't something a guy did in my neighborhood. So for a while, I thought that poetry was hazardous to my health, and it probably was. When I was in my late teens and early 20s, I became a folk singer. I lived in Greenwich Village. I taught guitar sometime. I played guitar and sang in coffee houses at night. And I got to really like blues and ballads from the Southern Appalachians and English, Irish, and Scottish ballads. And I was really taken by the language, the plain spoken language of these things. And I think those things affected my writing more than anything else in the beginning. So I never used fancy poetic devices. I don't reverse things just to make them rhyme. I really tried to write in a natural sounding kind of way. And I said, "Really? You mean you like my drawings?" And she said, "Oh no, you're the worst artist I've ever seen. But you have a natural gift here for writing rhyme and verse." I said, but Miss Hirschman, I work for 6 months on these drawings and 2 hours on these poems." She says, "Well, that doesn't matter. You're no good at this, you're very good at that." And I said, "You really like my poems?" She said, "Yes." I said, "That's wonderful, pay me." And she said, "Well, no, it doesn't work that way. This book is a little far out. Do you think you could write about real animals?" Well, it happens that I grew up in the Bronx, and I spent a lot of time when I was a kid going to the Bronx Zoo. And yes, I thought I could write about real animals. So she had me coming in, and I was about 23 years old. She had me coming in about once a week, and I'd bring her whatever animal poems I'd written. And she had a little drawer just for me in her desk. Maybe I'd give her 7 poems. She'd keep one, throw the other 6 out, put that one in her drawer. And then she'd take me to lunch, be the only decent meal I'd have in that week. Well, after months and months of this, we were close to a book. And she took me to a really wonderful lunch and said, "Jack, I think we need 5 more poems to do a book." And I was in despair. I didn't think I had another poem in me. But I went back down to my illegal living situation. I was living in a commercial loft illegally. And there was a notice on the door. Big red letters on white said, essentially, pay up or get out, 24 hours, this means you. Might have been 48 hours. It was from the U.S. Marshal. Well, sometimes people ask me what motivates me. That was a motivator. I went to my friend Harry's house and got about 2 quarts of black coffee, went back to the loft, and I started writing, and I stayed up all night, didn't sleep at all, and by morning I had written 6 poems. It was a Friday. I had no money. I had to walk to the publisher. I didn't make an appointment because I couldn't call the publisher. My phone had been disconnected. So I walked into the publisher, stormed in, and I said, "Susan, here are 6 poems, take them or leave them." And she looked at them and said, "Wow, this one, this one, this one, this one, and this one. This one's not so good. We have a book. We have a book? That's wonderful. Pay me." Oh, I had lots of odd jobs. Over the years, I was a furniture mover. I was a piano mover. I picked fruit. I had a brief job putting watch bands on watches. I was a janitor. I shoveled coal. I was a cab driver. I know there were some other things in there, but those are the ones that pop into my head right now. Nothing special, really, because I've met a lot of writers, and most of them, unless they were born with silver spoons in their mouth, and there are not that many of those, have had a lot of odd jobs. I think it's just part of paying your dues. Hooray for Diffin-Doofer Day, in a way, saved my life because I had just had cancer surgery. I had prostate cancer. And I had just gotten out of the hospital and I was in a lot of pain. And I was also, frankly, feeling sorry for myself. Guys do that, they feel sorry for themselves. And I didn't have much energy. And then this project came along. Dr. Seuss's widow had discovered fragments of a manuscript, something he had begun. It didn't have a title. What it had was a place, setting, a school. It had a few characters, some of whom I kept. It had a few verses, and it had a few drawings. And one of my publishers is Random House, that published all of Dr. Seuss's books. And I don't know if it's Random House or Knopf, actually, but it's they said, "What can you do with this?" And I said, "Well, I think I can do something." And the Seuss estate agreed that I was the one to do it. I had to pass muster on this. I had to get it past his agent, his widow, the lawyers. It was amazing. Well, I worked on it for a few hours every day, and then I'd go back to bed. But I had this feeling that he was standing and looking over my shoulder and collaborating with me. It's a little wacky, but nonetheless, I had that feeling. And I tried to write it in a style that was a combination of his style and mine, so that, first of all, you couldn't tell which verses were his, because he had about six or seven verses which I kept as much as I could. I kept just about all his verses, and I wove it into a story. There was a lot going on about testing in the schools at that time, and I thought, well, this is perfect. And that's what the book is about. And it's kind of an homage to teachers. It's not kind of an homage, it is an homage to teachers. It's all about teachers. Teachers teaching us how to think. When I did the first large anthology, poets were charging a lot less, and I was able to put in over 600 poems. When I did the 20th century anthology, it's about a third the size, and I think it cost more to do. I guess poets wised up. But the poetry I read when I was a kid, a lot of it was didactic. It was preachy. It was moralistic. It was condescending. Some of it was syrupy. That's not what kids want. I mean, kids are flesh and blood. They want stuff. They want good stuff. So I made it a point to avoid all of those things. I think that the best poets who've ever written for children are alive now and were alive in the last 20 or 30 years. It just changed. Poets realized that they could write about food fights and about aliens from outer space. Oh, I'm never without a notebook. I have one here. I wear cargo pants a lot, so it's easier for me to slip the notebook in. I always carry a notebook and at least two pens in case one runs out of ink. I'm a compulsive note taker. As it happens, last night I couldn't sleep. I woke up at 3:15 and I went into the bathroom of our hotel room so as not to wake my wife. Turn on the light and put the seat down on the toilet, sat down, and I wrote a poem of three verses that's for New Kid number 5 that I'm working on right now, a book that has no other title yet. It's about two dragons a little too macho for their own good. What happens when dragons meet each other and neither of them likes the other? And I wrote that last night between about 3 and 5 in the morning. So I'm always writing. I do most of my Finnish work at home, even because I've learned to write everywhere. I mean, I write in hotels, I write in restaurants, I write on airplanes, but sooner or later I have to get it down so it's legible and do the fine work, the tweaking, and I do that at home. I work on a computer, so I have to do that. But I have a stack of, I have taken so many notes over the years, I have a stack of notebooks now that if you piled them up, they would probably go way past the ceiling. Because I've been doing this for about 40 years, and I have a couple of drawers in a fire-resistant safe filled with them, and because I have this fear that I'll lose them. And I still haven't culled. There are ideas I haven't touched yet from 30, 40 years ago. And I'm going to have to do this next book because I'm running out of new ideas. Poetry can be fun. One of my very first reviews 40 years ago for my first book, A Gopher in the Garden, said that there's an old Greek idea about learning through laughing. Don't remember who said it. Don't remember who reviewed the book, and the reviewer didn't remember where the quote was from. But I've always kept that in mind. So I'm conscious that I am teaching things. I'm certainly teaching vocabulary, because I don't condescend. I use very complex vocabulary in some of my poems. I mean, words like mucilaginous and gelatinous and eviscerate, evaporate. I mean, I just wrote that dragon poem that I wrote last night. I got to put in a 6-syllable word, inextinguishable. But I'm conscious, I like to laugh, and I want to make other people laugh. And that's really what I'm trying to do. I just happen to be able to make those things rhyme. Would I have been better off writing prose? I don't think so. You know, there are plenty of people that do it so much better than I do or could. And I'm really happy to do what I'm doing. You see, these boring teachers I had, they would recite a poem and then say, now open your history book, your geography book, to page 122 or whatever. Well, my feeling is, find a poem that goes along with the other thing you're teaching. I mean, if you're teaching math, find some poems about math. If you're teaching about the food chain, you'll find plenty of funny poems about food. I used to talk about a poem called Willie Ate a Worm, and I say, do the food chain and talk about eating a worm. And don't be afraid to combine poetry with other media. So we've had kids set poems to music, combine them with art, make little paintings and mobiles and sculptures and dioramas, put on plays. Really, the only limit is their imagination and the teacher's imagination. I mean, it's all out there. It's like that the idea that the words are all out there. I mean, I didn't invent, except, well, I do invent some words, but basically all the words I've ever written are in the dictionary. It's just finding the way to combine them. Find the key. There's a key to every poem. Remember that when the poem was written, the poet wrote that poem because something happened to the poet first. It was something felt or thought or remembered or dreamt or experienced. So try to put a little of the same feeling into recreating the poem in the class that the poet put into writing the poem.
The Reading Rockets Meet the Author series is a production of WETA. Major funding for Reading Rockets comes from the United States Department of Education, Office of Special Education Programs. For more author interviews, recommended reading lists, and information about teaching kids to read, please visit us online at www.readingrockets.org.